brought us both success, obviously, with him as co-driver and myself. Huge. Those people have just been awesome. But as I say, everybody along the way. There's one guy that's not coming to this event because he reckons every time he goes to watch me, we blow up or crash or something. So he might come for the booze up later, but he's not coming to watch the event.
So a great chance in 2004 for the new drivers to come out from the shadows of Argyle and Herbert and take on this tough championship. Now, the Bayswater Rally of Hawke's Bay is unique because it starts with two night stages. Now, these have been gradually phased out of the championship over the last few years. So racing at night will be a real challenge for the younger drivers in the field who have little, if any, experience of doing it in the darkness. Fortunately, the weather for the rally was fine with little dust in the forest, so perfect conditions to go rallying. Starting in Napier, the Bayswater Subaru Hawke's Bay Rally is short compared with the other championship rounds. Just 157 kilometres, beginning with 23 k's through the Guavas Forest on Friday. Then six stages on Saturday, based around a service park at Wairoa, and featuring some of the best roads in New Zealand rallying, finishing with a sprint along the riverbank near Napier. So time to bolt on the lights as the crews headed out from Napier at 6.30 on Friday night and plenty of local support in the forest. Bruce Herbert was first away, and knowing that he didn't need to win the rally to take the championship crown would have reduced the pressure that he felt. Not surprising then, his time through the two night stages was 32 seconds down on the leader. What was surprising was that he was in second place, just 4 seconds in front of Jeff Argyle. The lead had been snatched by young Masterton driver Richard Mason, who won this rally in 2002. Despite not having a working intercom for the two opening stages, he charged through to take the early lead by 32 seconds from Herbert. Jeff Argyle really needed to lead this rally from the start to have any chance of overhauling Herbert's championship lead. But a loose moment on stage one dealt a blow to his confidence.
I lost quite a bit of confidence in the first one. I didn't realise we'd already done a five left and crunch called the next seven left over crest, and we just about put the whole car off the road. It was a very big moment.
Eight left, 100. Six right, 150.
Todd Borden had been the man to beat in round two and three, but his chances disappeared early in stage one when a brand new turbo broke and he lost 2 minutes and 45 seconds and struggled out of the stage.
Shut down the lights. And eight left, 100.
Blown turbo, brand new turbo, Hawke's Bay, first stage again, 2 k's into it, it went.
Bad luck continues.
Yeah, it's all over, mate.
Production car champ Chris West didn't need to come to Hawke's Bay after winning the title in Rotorua. So the mantle of top production car went to Mark Tapper. He was an impressive third overall through the night ahead of Argyle. Taranaki driver Glenn Smith was fifth championship driver, just 7 seconds ahead of Subaru driver Austin Jones. This was Jones' first appearance on the championship since Propecia Rally New Zealand, but he had a top finish here last year.
We've changed the setup in the car quite a bit, changed the final drive ratio, which means we've got to change our style a fair bit. It means the car goes a lot faster, it means we have to brake a lot more as well, so keeping it on the island's a bit more trickier, but hopefully at the end of the day it'll come right. Pretty tricky because I've got to totally change what I normally do. So, yeah, we're trying something new and hopefully we'll see what happens.
At the lower half of the top 10, it was a familiar battle led by production car rookie Danon Tebbleman in his Evo 6, just 4 seconds ahead of Rally Malaysia winners Brian Green and Fleur Pedersen. Green had left his winning Mitsubishi Evo 6 behind, choosing instead to run his X-Works Escort WRC car.
So fast, I was sort of about 2 gears too low all the time, and was on the brakes about half a kilometre before every corner, but we'll be right in the morning.
So you're just getting used to the car, of course, switching back to from the Lancer?
Well, it's going to be fair to say that we were just a passenger in here, actually. We'll have to get ready to think about what we're doing tomorrow morning.
So going into the service park back at Hastings, Richard Mason with a 32-second lead over Herbert, Tapper and Argyle. Non-championship entry, Lewis Scott doing well, equal fourth with Argyle. And just 23 seconds separated 6th to 12th places, although neither Stewart or Parker qualify for championship points. Todd Vorton didn't have a spare turbo at the rally, but Richard Mason did and was kind enough to loan it to the Vorton team just to get him going again. Sunrise on New Zealand's east coast in fine weather, blessed day two of the Rally Hawke's Bay as the crews left Napier to head to stages around Wairoa, starting with a 20 kilometre stage at Hiri Hiri Toll. Once again, it was Richard Mason who set the pace.
200 to a 6 right over crest, 60.
Now, this is the first rally that he and co-driver Laurie Brensnell have done together, but that certainly wasn't affecting his speed. In fact, Mason was nearly a second a K faster than the next fastest cars.
Long, four left minus.
The road surface is smooth gravel with even grip, so Mason's driving style was producing great results. What a spectacular view through the countryside here. Mason was once again the fastest and stretched his lead to 52 seconds. But Jeff Argyle was feeling more confident in the daylight. Argyle still had to push Herbert as hard as he could to force Herbert into a mistake and be in with a chance to take the title.
100, 6 wide over crest, 60. To an 8 by Keith Urban, 120. Six wide over crest, Keith Urban, 60 to 5 right, 200.
He was second fastest and reduced the deficit to Herbert here down to just 5 seconds.
Porsche, long 3 left, don't go wide, into long 5 right.
Herbert still held second overall, but remember, all he has to do is finish the rally, so there's no point for him to chase Mason. So with Mason, Herbert, Argyle in the top three, the battle line set, but who would fight out the top five? Mark Tapper and Glenn Smith had traded times through the night stages. Smith was faster through stage three, but Tapper's production car still had a 10-second edge on him in overall time. Dayton Templeman likewise was trading times with the Group A cars of Brian Green and Peter Day. In fact, Green and Templeman had the same time of 12.42 through stage three. Peter Day slipped back 30 seconds on these two, although he was still eighth overall. Grant Barber has made steady progress in his Evo 8 throughout the year, and now has become a top 10 contender in the championship field. But the drive of the day was once again coming from Christchurch driver Dean Buist, who had his front-wheel drive Corolla 10th overall in the Parker NZ Championship field and was comfortably leading the Kiwi two-wheel drive class. The flowing nature of these roads gives the little Corolla some advantage. Dean can keep up the momentum without losing traction coming out of the tight corners. And this car, remember, does have over 200 brake horsepower, so he's got plenty of top-end speed.
Five left into four right minus. 100.
But compare Buick's car to Todd Boredom, desperately fighting his way back through the field from 16th championship car after his turbo failure in stage one. He is nearly 1 minute faster than Buick through the 20k stage, but still 29 seconds slower than rally leader Mason.
5 left opens 120.
So at the first daylight service at Wairoa, the overall rally leaderboard is dominated by the Parker NZ Championship cars. While Mason now has nearly a minute lead over the field, the gap from second to fifth is just 31 seconds. No surprise that former championship driver Lewis Scott is the best placed of the club rally cars, and a great drive too by Peter Trotter and his club class Mitsubishi to hold 12th overall. Richard Mason's pace has the service park at Wairoa buzzing. No one expecting him to be nearly a minute ahead after just three stages.
Yeah, he's flying in there. I didn't think I was going that cautiously, so no, he's gone really well.
For Jeff Argyle, it's still a matter of hoping for bad luck to strike the leaders.
Yeah, had a reasonably good run through there. Unfortunately, we slipped a bridge halfway through and bent the one front rim on it, but luckily the tyres stayed up and we got through all right.
Yeah, it's excellent. Didn't feel like we were making any dangerous moves or silly corners or anything like that. Just a good drive through the stage and we're happy.
In the production class, Chris West's absence was giving the New Zealand young guns a chance to shine.
Yeah, no, we're pretty happy with it. We're a little bit off the pace from Mark, but we're slowly chipping away, slowly catching up to his speed. So we basically want to finish in the top six, so that helps our, like, you know, get a B seed. So as long as we can, you know, chip away at it and get a little bit quicker, that's sort of our game plan now.
Well, we made a few changes, and it's just a matter of changing my driving style to suit them, as they seem to make the car faster. But I've got to behave myself and drive into them.
Still to come on Rally Hawke's Bay, a close call for a few brave competitors.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'd also like...
Newly crowned New Zealand production rally champion Chris West had come to Hawke's Bay to lend support to his Dynalink teammate Bruce Herbert. The Timaru driver is having a great year as he's been given a chance to drive for the Japanese STI Subaru team in Rally Australia next week.
Yeah, like with us... retaining our championship here. We've had been fortunate enough to be picked up by Subaru Rally Team Japan with STI, and we're competing in round 10 of the championship in Perth, which is the first week in September. So it's a fantastic opportunity for myself, and we'll be able to get ourselves our first overseas event, and we'll be obviously looking for a finish and gather experience and hopefully be asked to back again and get the opportunity to do something else with them in the future.
And add to the prestige of the STI drive, Chris learned at the rally that he's been awarded the Propecia Rally Scholarship for 2003.
It's Propecia Scholarship is important. It's something that obviously the younger guys can go and chase, and it does give you a handy help and an entry to Rally NZ next year. So without it, just goes towards the package, the overall event, and helps you probably do it a wee bit more comfortable, and know that that you've got a reasonable package money wise and support with fuel and accommodation, and not only with that, we're with a trip to the RAC in Great Britain in November is just it's an awesome experience to be away with Pro Drive and Subaru for a week is something I'm really looking forward to.
The rally now moved on to the 31-kilometre Waihee stage and the awesome Cricklewood Road stage, a total of 56 k's before the next service.
2, 1, go. 20 to a 5 right, 60. 8 left, 20 to a long 4 right, 30.
It was obvious that this was Richard Mason's day. No one had the pace to match him, and once again, he increased his lead by 19 seconds on stage 4.
20 to a 4 right minus.
On stage 5, it was the same story. Another 19-second stage win, and now his lead was out to 1 minute and 50 seconds. Todd Borden was on a charge for these two stages as he tried to claw his way back into contention after a stage 1 disaster. He was second fastest on stage 4, but it wasn't without a few moments.
5 right minus, don't cut, and 6 left plus. 6 left plus, and 4 right tightens, opens,
4 late there, buddy.
4 right opens, 60, long 4 left, and 7 right. 7 right, 6 left, 120. 4 right, 250.
What have we got here?
4 right, 250. Left kink.
Then near the end of the stage, another heart-stopping moment that left the car with a crushed turbo pipe. Borden still managed to be the fifth fastest on the stage and had climbed back to eighth championship car by the end of stage five. Jeff Argyle's chances of winning the rally and the championship, however, were all but gone. A leak was developing in the exhaust manifold, robbing the car of power, and he had brake problems. Slowly but surely, he was slipping back from Herbert here on stage four. The gap was 13 seconds. But by the time Argyle reached the end of stage five, the gap to Herbert was now 36 seconds. But a puncture for Herbert or Mason could still lose them 3 minutes, so it wasn't quite time to concede defeat just yet. In fact, Herbert lost concentration and some time when he overshot this corner on stage four. It was fortunate that the three times champion chose here to go off, as you can see how big the drops are to the left of the road as it climbs up the hill. In contrast, here at the stage end, the road is tight and twisty again, more suited to the Subaru. Tattle was once again the fastest production car, and by the end of stage four, he was in fourth place, just 9 seconds behind Argyle. But on stage five, it was Dainham Templeman who emerges as the production car leader when Tapper left the road and damaged his intercooler hose, leaving the car stranded. So Glenn Smith took over fourth championship place, although by the end of stage five, he was back to sixth overall, behind the non-championship club cars of Scott and Parker, despite the car having a turbo problem.
We thought we actually could get those two, but early in that stage, we lost all boost, so I don't know what happened, so we've lost quite a bit of time in there.
Brian Green was starting to use the superior power and handling of his WRC Escort, and he crept past Damon Templeman. At the end of five, he was just 22 seconds behind Smith, but Templeman was just a further 10 seconds behind him. Emma Gilmore's had a miserable season, and a problem with the car mysteriously stopping on stage three had dropped her to 11th championship car. But a big charge on these stages saw her back in the top 10 of the champ cars and slowly closing in on Peter Day. Day had drifted back from the Templeman Green battle and slowed with a puncture. Likewise, Grant Barber was out on his own, second in the production cars. But there was a good battle for third place production car. Dean Sumner, just 8 seconds in front of John Giltrap. Aside from Chris West, Giltrap has been the most consistent competitor in the production class and has had a chance now to claim second in their championship with Mark Tapper's demise. The Kiwi front-wheel drive class was once again a one-horse race. Dean Buist had a three-minute lead over the next competitor in that class and was just outside the top 10 championship cars. No doubt his performance reflected the nature of these fast-flowing roads. The best conditions for the small car, but his dominance over the other competitors was still outstanding.
Dean, you look a little bit tired after those big long stages.
They were hard work, those were. They were cool stages, though.
Yeah, a lot of the top guys are saying that the roads here are fantastic. You see, find the same?
Oh, yeah. I think I've done them before years ago, but yeah, those last two stages just mint.
Jason West and Kane Barry were making a fight for second in the class. In stage four, Barry held second, but West charged past on stage five to hold a three-second advantage. Sarah Randall had secured second place in the Kiwi class, and running the last of the championship cars, she was being caught on the stages by a hard-charging Neil Allport, who was running first on the road in the Clubman's Rally, following the Parker NZ field. But the 17-year-old schoolgirl was still fizzing from the experience.
Pretty hard. I'm knackered after the mow. It was just really hard work.
And how did you find the road conditions and the roads, the way the roads flowed? Was it quite good in this area?
Oh, yeah, they're awesome. I loved that first stage this morning. It was just beautiful, gorgeous.
So with the service of Wairoa, Mason was well out in front with that huge lead of 1 minute 50. Glenn Smith was fourth in the Parker NZ field, and the closest battles were lower down. Templeman, just 10 seconds off Green, and Gilmore, only 3 seconds behind Todd Borden. The Parker NZ Rally Championship brought to you by the winning team at One Card. Well, when he wasn't playing rugby in the Naki, former All Black Bull Allen used to be an auto electrician with his old man. I've actually been to the workshop down there to see the bull in action. And today he's dialed into the ever-changing role the computer plays in the modern-day rally car.
Thanks, Clint. When I served my apprenticeship with Dad, this was engine management, a carby and a distributor. Haven't things changed? These days, with electronic fuel injection and ignition systems, this little box controls the show. It's the ECU, the car's brain. This box not only controls fuel and ignition, but many other functions on rally cars, such as turbo boost. In fact, how this is programmed can have more effect on horsepower and torque than any other part of the car. That's why when rally cars pull in to be serviced, the laptop computer's often pulled out before the spanner.
So now just two more stages around Wairoa before a final publicity stage along the river at Hastings. The 17-kilometre Mohaka Coach Road and the 29K Mohaka Forest would see a return to the tighter, more technically demanding stages. Bruce Herbert didn't need to win a stage to win the championship, but no driver likes being beaten on every stage, so this was his chance to put the hammer down. At the stage down, he was flying. In this tight section, the Subaru really works well. But then Herbert notices a change in the car. There's less traction. And by the end of the stage, co-driver Robert Ryan realises they have a problem.
What's happened to it?
I think it's just gravel.
Do you?
Yeah.
I reckon we've tried to send a dip.
3, 2, 1, go. 3 right 20, 4 left 20.
So once again it's Mason who's in control. He shows no sign of backing off and looks determined to finish the rally at least 3 minutes in front of his rivals. Check out how hard he's driving through this tight section.
4 right. Plus, 4 left, 3 right opens, 20, we're short, 4 left minus, 20, 5 left minus, 4 right, 20, 4 left, 30, 4 left, we're 4 right plus 60.
can hear now that Argyle's manifold leak is getting worse, but it doesn't dampen his enthusiasm or that of co-driver Crunch Bennett.
Well, now 7 left over crest, 250.
Just 3 seconds slower than Herbert on the stage, but now the gap overall was 39 seconds. But if Herbert's diff problem got worse, there was still a slim chance of overhauling him. Todd Borden's rally season started with a mechanical breakdown on Rally NZ, got back going again with two superb drives and two wins down south, faltered with the crash at Rotorua, and now, well, it would finish as it began.
Two left, 50. Long, three left. 50. Was that Toddy?
Engine has expired, B.
A broken cam belt finally putting an end to their rally. Glenn Smith looked unchallenged in fourth place overall, although he'd been hoping for a podium finish. And Brian Green and Peter Day leapfrogged ahead of Damon Templeman, who blew a turbo on the stage and would now have to nurse the car home. So, stage 7, Mohaka Forest, and the big question was, how bad was Herbert's diff problem? Was the worst place for this to happen, as you can see here how narrow and slippery the stage is. But still compare Herbert and Argyle over the same track, and amazingly, Herbert is still faster.
Bruce, one stage to go. Any further problems with that centre diff?
Yeah, it's definitely gone. We're just two-wheel drive, so hopefully we'll be the quickest two-wheel drive cars through there.
You can't see that being a problem. Won't stop you in the rally at all?
It shouldn't do, no. It's just a matter of... That was the hardest one to do with it, so we should be okay now. It's pretty well straight through to that triple bridges, so now we should be okay.
But the battle came to an end 5 kilometres before the end of the stage. Argyle's car stops when the leaking exhaust fumes burn through a power cable, and he would lose around 8 minutes and drop out of the top 10.
The short portion left can't get the long four right.
So Glenn Smith found himself in third.
Glenn, you've just come out of the second and last stage. Looks like there's no Jeff Argyle. Did you see him in there?
Yeah, it looks like he's blowing an engine in there and just parked up. You can just smell the oil when we went past. And yeah, put him out, which is a bit of a shame for the guy, but moves us to place, I suppose.
Yeah, that's right. That will basically put you on the podium for the championship. You've been on the podium before?
Once, only ever once at Rally NZ a couple of years ago. I think we were third national championship home, so... But it'd be great to be on there again.
Brian Green used the superior traction of his WRC Escort to leapfrog the club cars and put himself into fourth place outright. Emma Gilmore posted her best championship stage time, fifth fastest, and moved up to fifth place in the champ cars. But Damon Templeman struggled to hold on to the lead in the production class with a sick Evo 6. Grant Barber, Dean Sumner and John Gultrap all had their production cards closing in for the kill. Barber was now just 6 seconds behind Templeman, while rookie Sumner had done well to be back in top 10 contention after being slowed with punctures on the early stages. Gultrap had done enough to secure second place in the production car championship. Dean Buer still held an amazing 4 minute lead over Jason West in the Kiwi two wheel drive class. Not that it mattered for the championship, but he had relinquished the overall two-wheel drive lead in the rally to Jason Weld in this amazing Datsun Sunny hybrid. So with just one stage to go, Richard Mason looks set to secure his second consecutive Rally Hawke's Bay win, and Bruce Herbert could taste the champagne for that fourth Parker NZ title. But look at the changes further down the ladder. The club cars of Parker and Stewart tied in fifth place after seven stages, and a great effort by Peter Trotter to have his Evo up to seventh. A huge crowd turned out to watch the cars through the final stage on the Ngaru Roro riverbank on the outskirts of Napier. Sarah Randall was the last of the 15 Parker NZ finishers, but in her first season of the championship, she's finished second in the Kiwi two-wheel drive class, and that's a great effort. Kane Barry was third of the Kiwi class, but had lost time during the day to Jason West, finishing 2 minutes behind him. West had the Suzuki flying over the jump here, but third place in the Kiwi two-wheel drive class in the rally would earn him third in the two-wheel drive championship. Peter Day put a string of problems behind him to be ninth fastest on the stage and finished 12th place in the championship cars. Jeff Argyle had to settle for 11th. He got going again after bypassing the burnt-out power lead on stage 7 after losing over 8 minutes. But it was a disappointing end to his Parker NZ Championship career.
Jump 200 to 5 right, cut.
2, 1, go. 200.
When you consider how much time Dean Buist's two-wheel drive Corolla loses off the start line to the four-wheel drive cars, his 10th championship place result is all the more incredible to add to his 4 minute margin over Jason West, and this was a stunning way to finish the season. John Gultrap had been Mr. Consistent in the production class throughout the championship and was rewarded with second place in the production class for the season behind Chris West. Production class rookie Dean Sumner was third in the class and eighth Parker NZ finisher. Danum Templeman's sick Evo 6 was just 4 seconds in front of Grant Barber going into the last stage. So all he could do was push the car as hard as it would go and hope he could hold on to the class lead. But Barber was too quick in his Evo 8 and moved into 6th place in the championship finish and amazed himself by winning the production class for the rally. Emma Gilmore's had a miserable season in the Parker NZ Championship, but made up for it here with a great drive into 5th place. And great to see a world rally car on New Zealand roads again, thanks to Brian Green. He would finish in 4th. While most of the competitors shortcut the stage through the grass, Glenn Smith was taking no risks at all on his way to his best result of the year, 3rd overall, 1 minute 39 behind Bruce Herbert. Yeah. What a year for Bruce Herbert and Rob Ryan. Five Rally Rotorua titles, five times co-driver champion for Rob Ryan, and now Herbert on the way to his record fourth New Zealand Rally Championship.
Six left past 200. Five right into a short four left. 30. Short six right plus 80.
But even on this final stage, there was a last-minute scare when the engine of the normally bulletproof Subaru started to have a problem.
Eight right, 200. Four right. Is it right?
No.
No power?
No power.
Turn any leg off.
Thankfully, they got to the end to finish the rally 3 minutes and 56 seconds behind Richard Mason. Like that, Mason could have cruised through the stage to finish, but in what was to be one of the most outstanding and dominant performances of the year, he charged to the end to be rewarded with his first championship win for 2003.
Great way to finish the year for us, and the whole team worked so hard. We did the engine, the gearbox, the diff, the rear diff, the suspension, everything got looked over, and it was just completely faultless. The whole rally, it was perfect.
Sash, was it your dominance of the rally? You won the rally by 4 minutes. I think you won every special stage. You must like the roads around this area.
I do like the roads around this area, but the car just felt perfect, and it was just, it felt right to be going the speed we were. We weren't doing any silly stuff. It was just great.
So looking at those results, a great performance for Mason, but also a close battle for third, with Green getting to just 39 seconds of Glenn Smith in the end. And a great performance too by the Clubman's Rally Class cars of Wayne Parker and Malcolm Stewart. But in the end, it was Bruce Herbert and Rob Ryan who capped off a very special year by winning the overall Parker NZ Championship.
We never knew it was in the bag, probably until maybe a couple of stages to go. Jeffrey had his problem, and then we thought, well, he's not going to win it from there, so we've got it. But, yeah, big battle.
And over the, I know it hasn't been this year, but generally over the last 4 years, the word domination comes to mind. What's been the key ingredient to that?
Car preparation, really. Our car has just been reliable every time we've taken it out, basically. I think it's had one DNF in 3 years in its career. So, yeah, and it's always gone well. But today it maybe gave us a wee drama at the end, but otherwise, like, it's just been fantastic.
So a great finish to his rally career for Bruce Herbert. And, of course, his top co-driver, Robert Ryan. Good to see you guys go out in style. And that's it, the end of the Parker NZ Championship for another year. Now, the championship is actually undergoing a review by Motorsport New Zealand. And next year, we should see at least one new rally added to the program, hopefully before the local drivers have to take on Propecia Rally of New Zealand in April, which is always a big ask to go straight into the international without a warm-up. Also, in 2005, the championship will align itself with the rest of the world and be open to production cars only. But that's not the end of the rallying on three. Next week, it's Rally Australia. The coverage starts on Saturday night, 11 o'clock, right after MPC Rugby, and then on Sunday from 3 to 4, and finishes on Monday night, 11 o'clock after Nightline. And with 11 points between the top three drivers, Burns, Sainz and Gronholm, Aussie should be an absolute cracker, especially after Burns confirmed his switch back to Subaru next year, and Gilles Panisi is now signed up with Mitsubishi for 2004. So that's all still coming up with the WRC on three, but next up, Hamish has the rugby. It's the Mighty Mulus against the Taniwha in the MPC. I'm Clint Brown. Thanks for watching. We'll catch you later.